can see it. Mm-hmm. So we start. Now let me announce the
Isernia.
Last talk of this session, and it will be delivered by Professor Irsenia, and she will talk on partial regularity for elliptic and parabolic systems with Ehrlich growth. So please, you have 20 minutes.
Yes, thank you. Okay, please, firstly, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to be here today. In this talk, I will speak about partial regularity for elliptic and parabolic systems with Ehrlich growth. More precisely, let us consider the following systems, minus divergence of AXU and U equals to B of XU and U in omega, where omega is a bounded open set in Rn with the dimension n greater or equal than 2, U is a vector valued function with n greater than 1, The function A satisfies ellipticity and growth conditions in terms of Ehrlich function, and I will set the precise assumption in a few. And for what concerns B, we will assume that B has a natural growth or a critical growth condition. Let me start saying that with the definition. We say that phi is an n function if phi in 0 is equal to 0, there exists a right continuous non-decreasing derivative phi prime, such that phi prime in 0 is 0, phi prime is positive or t positive, and goes to infinity as t goes to infinity. Especially we are considering a convex function. Typical examples of n functions are t to the power p with p greater than 1, e to the power t minus t minus 1, or e to the power t to the power p minus 1 with p greater than 1, and also t to the power p log to the power alpha and 1 plus t with p greater than 1 and alpha positive. Starting from an n function, we can define the shifted n function starting from the derivative of phi. That is, for any a greater or equal than 0, we can define phi prime of a in t as phi prime in a plus t times t over a plus t. So we can see that phi A has all the good properties of the function phi uniformly in A. The main assumption that we made on the function phi is the following. We assume that phi is a C1 function in 0 infinity and C2 in 0 infinity is an n function that satisfies these inequalities. More precisely, we have that the inf of t phi 2 prime over phi prime is less than the sup of t phi 2 prime over phi prime, and are bounded from above and from below by two positive constants, namely p0 minus 1 and p1 minus 1, where p0 and p1 are related by these inequalities. Let me say that from this assumption, in particular, it follows that the function phi is a delta 2 function. That is, there exists a positive constant C for which phi into T is less or equal than C times phi of T for all T positive. Moreover, from this assumption, we can see that the n function interpolates between two powers that are P0 and P1, and it depends on the fact that S behaves is in 0, 1 or is greater than 1. Furthermore, we have that phi and phi prime and phi prime and phi 2 prime are related by this equivalence. Now, if we take an n function phi that satisfies the delta 2 condition, then we can define the Ehrlich space as the set of measurable functions u from omega into Rn for which the integral of phi of u is finite. And we define the Luxembourg norm in this way. And by W1 phi, we denote the Ehrlich Sobolev space. That is the set of, we say that u belongs to W1 phi whenever u and u belongs to L phi. Okay, as I said in the first slide, we are speaking about partial regularity. Well, De Giorgi and Giustin Miranda proved that in contrast with the equations, in general, in the case of systems, we cannot expect that a weak solution is a classical solution. And the best we can hope for is a partial regularity. That is the regularity outside a negligible set. More precisely, there exists an open set R of U in omega, that is the set of regular point, such that the singular set omega minus R of U has zero Lebesgue measure, and U, or the gradient of U, is locally regular in R of U. So at this point, the natural question is, what are the suitable assumptions on the vector field A that guarantees the partial regularity for a weak solution? The first result that in this setting we can mention is are the papers by Giusti and Miranda, in which the authors considered this kind of system, this kind of elliptic quasi-linear second order system, the divergence of A of XU times du equals zero in omega. And by assuming that the vector field A are uniformly elliptic and continuous in omega times Rn, the authors proved that the solutions are order continuous with exponent 1 alpha, except that except omega 0, for which the Lebesgue measure of omega minus omega 0 is 0. After this paper, the question that regards conditions on the vector field A, what are the suitable conditions on the vector field A in order to obtain the partial regularity, has been for a long time investigated. In the paper by Duzzara and Grotowski, by considering the quadratic case, the authors proved the order continuity, proved the order regularity by assuming the order continuity with respect to x and u. While Fosse and Mingione improved this result by requiring only the continuity with respect to x and u, and subsequently in two papers, Bogelin, Duzzara, Habermann, and Schiven, and Bogelin extended this result by requiring a VMO condition in X and a continuity assumption on U. Well, but in these two papers, in the first one, the author considered the case P greater or equal than 2, and in the second one, the case P between 1 and 2. Very recently, Ock established the partial order regularity in the case of Orlich growth, but considering only the superquadratic case and in a non-degenerate situation. And furthermore, we have a very recent result by Celado-Kay and Goodrich, Schill and Stroffolini in this direction. Let me say the assumptions we made on the vector field A. We assume that A has a phi growth condition, that is, A is less than lambda phi prime, and the gradient of A with respect to the third variable is less than the second derivative of lambda. We assume, with respect to the second derivative of phi, we assume the following ellipticity condition, and moreover, we have the order continuity away from zero. This is a quite standard assumption when we deal with the regularity in the case of Orlich setting. Moreover, we have the phi Laplacian behavior at the origin. This is due to the fact that we are considering both cases, degenerate and non-degenerate regime, but I will specify better in a few. We assume a VMO condition with respect to the X variable, that is A in X u x e minus the average of A with respect to the X variable is less than the constant lambda WX0 phi prime, where WX0 is a bounded function that satisfies the following relational limit. The limit of capital W in rho goes to zero as rho goes to zero, where capital W is defined in the following way. And finally, we assume the continuity with respect to the second variable. Here, omega is the modulus of continuity, it's a non-decreasing concave modulus of continuity. For what concerns the inhomogeneity B, we assume that B can have or a controllable growth, so a natural growth. B is controlled by the first derivative of phi, or a critical growth, that is, B is controlled by phi itself. And in this case of critical growth, we need to assume a smallness assumption. The first result obtained together with Chiara Leone and Anna Verde is the following. Let U be in W1 phi a weak solution to our problem under all controllable or critical growth. Then there exists an open subset omega 0 in omega for which U is C0 alpha in omega 0 and the Lebesgue measure of omega minus omega 0 is 0. Moreover, the set of the regular points is defined in this way where sigma 1 and sigma 2 are these two sets. Here we can see that we have the B function. This function is defined through the square root of phi prime of zeta over zeta times zeta. And this function satisfies this relation, that is the square of B is equivalent to the function phi itself. Let me say that under these work assumptions we made on the function A and on the function B, the partial order continuity is the best regularity we can expect under this assumption. And moreover, while in the previous paper in the literature, there are the authors needed to distinguish between the case P greater than 2 or P between 1 and 2, here we give a unified approach for both superquadratic and subquadratic case. And here we are working in both non-degenerate and degenerate regime. The idea of the proof is the following. First, the main ingredient is the Cacioppo inequality. But let me say that here the Cacioppo inequality is not the standard Cacioppo, but is quite different because of our this extra term, C times phi of the L H, and the H takes into account the VMO condition here, W, capital W, with respect to the X variable, and takes also into account the modulus of continuity with respect to the second variable U. And let me stress the fact that when the affine function L is equals to U0, a constant, then we have the classical Cacioppo inequality, the zero order Cacioppo inequality. Once we have a Cacioppo inequality, we want to establish an excess decay estimate. Well, we define three excess functional in this setting. The first functional is the following. Phi is defined as the average of a shifted phi function in U minus L over R. Here L again is the unique affine function that minimizes this functional amongst all the affine functions. Then we define the functional phi star that takes into account of the previous functional phi and takes also into account the dependence on x and u. And finally, we have psi alpha. Psi alpha is the functional that measures the oscillation of the function u. Once we have this, we would like to linearize. That is, we would like to apply a comparison principle with a weak solution to a suitable linearized system. In order to do this, we could use the blow-up technique employed by Giusti and Miranda. But in our setting, it is not possible due to the non-homogeneity of the function phi. And otherwise, we can use the harmonic approximation method. This method has been originally introduced by De Giorgi in the context of minimal surfaces, and subsequently has been developed in the case of power growth by Dozzaro and Mingione, and in the case of Orlich growth by Diening, Langer, Stroffolini, and Verde. Let me say that take A a strongly elliptic bilinear form with ellipticity constant nu and with upper bound lambda. We say that map H in W12 is an aharmonic function if it satisfies this relation. That is, an aharmonic map in the ball BR is a weak solution to a constant coefficient elliptic system in the ball BR. Well, Dozzaro and Mingione, the aharmonic approximation lemma given by Dozzaro and Mingione says that for any given epsilon positive, there exists a positive constant delta in 0, 1 that depends on the dimension small and capital N, on the nu and the lambda, and on epsilon, with the following property. For any A strongly elliptic bilinear form, and for any function u in W12 that satisfies this inequality and that is approximately harmonic in the sense that this integral is less or equal than the positive constant delta times the sup of the gradient of xi, then we can find an aharmonic function that satisfies this inequality and also delta norm of u minus h is small enough. The lemma by Diening, Langer, Stroffolini, Verde in the case of phi growth says that if we have a function u almost aharmonic in the sense that here we have the constant delta, the L infinity norm of the gradient of xi times average of the gradient of u, then we can find a function h in W1 phi for which this inequality holds true. Well, in our setting, the A approximation lemma is a little bit precise in the sense that we need here the positive constant delta zero, the L infinity norm of the gradient of xi, and here we have to compare our functional phi star with the function of phi. And then we can find an harmonic function H, such that h is equal to u on the boundary of the ball, and this inequality holds true. And thanks to the Sobolev-Poincaré inequality, we can go further in this way. At this stage, we need to distinguish between the non-degenerate and the degenerate situation. In the non-degenerate case, that is when our functional phi is less than phi in the L, we can linearize our problem by defining in this way the function A, and we can prove that U minus L here, thanks to our theorem, is an approximate harmonic function. At this point, by using a comparison argument, we obtain this inequality, and we can start with the iteration argument. In the degenerate regime, instead, we need to take into account of this hypothesis, the phi Laplacian behavior at the origin. In this way, we have that our function A minus xi over xi times phi prime, let me say that this is the Ehrlich tensor, is less or equal than delta times phi prime. In this situation, we cannot use our A harmonic approximation lemma, but we need to use the phi harmonic approximation lemma due to Diening, Stroffolini, and Verde to obtain the desired result. And at this stage, we can prove the excess estimate, and we can start with the iteration. But we need to combine both the regimes. So if we take that phi in R is less than delta star and phi alpha is less than k star, then we can prove that the sup of our excess functional is less or equal than c. And taking x0 in the set of the regular point, we can obtain in this way that the sup of this quantity is finite. That is, u belongs to lp0 n plus p0 alpha in b rho. And by using Campanato characterization of order continuous function, we get the desired result. At this point, we investigate about parabolic systems of the type ut minus the divergence of a over the u equals zero in omega t. Here, omega t is omega times minus t zero with the t positive. Omega, again, is a bounded open set in Rn with n greater than two. U is from omega t in Rn with the capital N greater than one. And again, the vector field A satisfies ellipticity and growth conditions in terms of Ehrlich function. Let me say that the prototype that we have in mind is the parabolic phi Laplacian system of this type, where phi is a given and a function. And in the model case, that is when phi is equal to 1 over p s to the power p with p greater than 1, we have the non-degenerate evolutionary phi Laplacian system. In this setting, the starting point is the paper by Di Benedetto and Friedman, in which the authors considered the Uhlenbeck structure and they proved that the special gradient of weak solutions is bounded and order continuous. And subsequently, they introduced the intrinsic scale method, which accommodates both the cases p greater than 2 and less than 2. While for a general A, which depends on x, t, u, and xi with the quadratic growth, it remains an open problem, the problem of the acaloric approximation method, until the paper by Duzzara and Mingione. When A is an order continuous function with respect to x, u, x, t, and u with p greater than 2, Duzzara, Mingione, and Steffen established the partial regularity of the special gradient of solution, and Schiemann extended this result in the case p less than 2. By improving Bogelin, Fosse, Mingione, and subsequently Fosse and Gessbauer, improved this result by assuming the continuity of the coefficient and not the order continuity. And very recently, Mons established the partial order continuity when we have a BMO condition with respect to x and u. In the model case, that is when we consider the A function as like G of the U times the U with the G, a C2 function that satisfies this inequality that is just like a PQ growth, you proved the boundedness of solutions. Lieberman instead considered this assumption on the function G that is almost a Norlich function and established the order continuity of the gradient of solutions. In my PhD thesis, I proved that if we consider here a Norlich tensor, then by assuming that phi is an N function that satisfies the good regularity and phi prime is equivalent to T phi 2 prime and this increasing relation, then we have that if U is in L2, then the U is in L infinity. And Diening, Charles, Schwarzager proved this result by removing these assumptions by requiring only the delta 2 condition. Well, if we take a phi function in an function phi, then if U is in L infinity, thanks to the result by U, we can say that the U is in L2. The result by Diening allows to say that the gradient of U is in L infinity, and we can use the result by Lieberman to say that U is in C1 alpha, but it is missing the starting point. That is, if we take U a weak solution of the model case in the Orlich setting, then we have that U is in L infinity, and they proved this result 4 years ago. Why, when we have-
Sorry to interrupt, but the time is up.
Okay, thank you.
But the talk is great.
Thank you for the kind attention.
I have one question. What can you say about the kind of finer characterization of this singular set? So not in terms of just Lebesgue measure, but maybe some Hausdorff measure, or can you say something about it?
No, we do not study the measure of the set of the singular set. Maybe you can refer to the papers due to Christensen and Mingione.
I know that he studied it, and so. Maybe
we don't want to say anything about the measure of the Lebesgue set, yes.
Mm-hmm.
How can we estimate this set? No, we do not study this part.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. More questions, please. So then let's thank our speaker again.
Thanks a lot.